Hey guys, and welcome to part 2 of Create Your Own Webshop with ESP.NET. In today's lesson, we will be building the database that we are going to be using in future lessons. Today is going to be all about building and maintaining a relational database in Microsoft SQL Server. Today is going to be quite heavy on theory, so I do apologize for that. In fact, if you're already quite familiar with relational databases, you might as well just download the SQL script from the video below and skip this lesson altogether. On today's menu, I will show you how to build your own SQL Server tables and how to link them together using primary and foreign keys and relationships. I will also discuss the importance and benefits of using a relational database as opposed to a flat database. And I will also show you some DB best practices, such as using indexes for optimizations, defaults, some basic data types, and so on and so on. You will need some sort of database management tool for this lesson. You can either use Visual Studio's built-in Server Explorer, or you can use Microsoft SQL Server Management Studio. Personally, I prefer Management Studio as it's more powerful and I think it's easier to use. If you don't have it, you can download it from the link in the description below this video. Don't worry, you can do everything in this lesson in Server Explorer as well, but I do recommend now and in the future to use Server Management Studio. Let's skip ahead a bit and take a look at the tables that we are going to be building. We will need a table to store the information about the products that we are going to be selling. So we'll make a table called Products and give it the following columns. We'll need a column for the product name, one for the price. We'll also need one to store an image pod, and a product will also need a product type, as well as a short description about what the product does. In a later lesson, I will show you how you can let your users log in and register on your site. This is required for them to be able to purchase items from your store. Visual Studio has automated the process of writing a login and registration procedure, so we do not need to write a database table for that by hand. So we can just skip over that part and move over to the table which we will need for a shopping cart. Since we're going with a database first approach in this series, we haven't built a shopping cart yet. But don't worry, we'll see about that in a later lesson. For now, let's just look at the columns that a shopping cart table is going to need. First and foremost, we will need the ID of the user that is currently browsing the store. We will also need the ID parameters of the items that are currently being purchased, as well as the quantities of those items. Last but not least, this table will also require a boolean or bit value to determine whether the object is still in the shopping cart or has already been purchased. Okay, let's get started. We are going to be using our own local machines as database testing environments. To do this, either open up SQL Server Management Studio or Visual Studio Server Explorer. Either one is fine, and use your own local machine as a database. To do this, type in localhost / SQL Express in the server name window and make sure that Windows authentication is selected, and then hit the connect button. This will open up a local database session. First thing which we will need to do is create a new database. To do this, look for the Databases folder in the Object Explorer, right-click it and select New Database. And give it a fitting name. I'm going to call mine GarageDB. And hit the OK button. There are two possible ways of creating a table. The first is by typing in SQL code manually, and the second one is by using the table designer. We will be discussing both methods in this lesson, starting with the table designer. Open up the databases folder and open up the newly created GarageDB and look for the tables folder. Right-click it and select New Table. This will take us to SQL Server's table designer. Let's start with a bit of theory about primary keys. A primary key is usually a number in a table that uniquely identifies a single record in a table. It is not required to have a primary key, but it is very recommended as it brings home several advantages. One of those advantages is that a key has to be unique, so there is no chance for duplicate data in that column. It will also speed up queries against a table, and it will also by default display data sorted using the primary key. The biggest advantage for now about the primary key is that it makes a record unique. Let me show you with a simple example. Take a look at the sample data below. So this is a sample employee database. And each employee has a last name, first name, a title, a city, and a country. Suppose we want to update the title of employee and Dotsword. Can you see the problem? There are two and Dotsword in this table. If you would need to update the employee living in New York, we would need to type in a query the likes of update where last name is equals Dotsword, first name equals N, and city equals New York. This is a pretty long query, and it's also quite dangerous, as there is a real possibility that there are multiple N Dotswords living in New York. A unique identifier, or primary key, would be ideal to solve this problem. In fact, this table has one. In a column called employee ID, so let's add it to the select query. And as you can see, each employee has their unique incremental number. So using primary keys, we would simply need to type in a query set title where employee ID equals 11. This is a far, far shorter query, and it's also much safer as there is only one possible employee with the ID 11. There is also an additional advantage to using primary keys, as they are very suitable to link several relational tables together. But we are going to discuss that later in this lesson. For now, we are going to start creating the tables. For real this time. Alright. So go back to your table designer, and let's start by creating the table products. I hope I made my points about the importance of primary keys, so let's create one. Add a new column name called ID, set its data type to int, and uncheck allow nulls. To set this column as a primary key, right-click it and select Set Primary Key. This will make sure that each number entered in this column has to be unique. We're also going to make this an identity record. So look for the identity specification in the column properties. Open it and set the isIdentity parameter to yes. This will increment the primary key column each time when a new row is inserted. For example, the first row inserted will have primary key number 1, the second will have number 2, the third one number 3, and so on and so on. Now we just need to add the other columns slash parameters. As mentioned before, a product object had a type, a name, description, image, and a price. So let's create those columns. First, type in a type ID and set it to int. This column is going to be a foreign key to another table, I'll explain that in a little while. Next column is going to be name, and set its data type to varchar 100. What this means it is that it will only allow a string with a maximum amount of 100 characters. Next one is price. Its data type is going to be an int. Description. Set its data type to text, which is actually a varchar of 3000 characters. And last but not least, image. Let's say varchar 150. Note that we are not going to store actual images in this table, but rather we are going to store a link in them to the location where we will store the image on the server. When the allow nulls checkbox is checked, this means that this column will accept empty values. So when we enter a row in which, for example, there is no name, the column name will contain a null value. I don't really like nulls. A good way to remedy those is to provide a default value. What this does is when a column gets a null value, it will replace the null value by whatever is in the default value or bindings. So if I were to type in unknown over here, then the column name will have an unknown value each time a null record is inserted. This is not mandatory, but it's a good practice to do this. So if you'd like, you can put a default value everywhere, like this. But once again, it is not required. Then save your table by hitting the disk icon or pressing Ctrl S and call it product. There we go. Let me explain the principle of foreign keys. A foreign key is a column that references the primary key of another table, which essentially links those two tables together. For example, we have table column type ID over here, which will be referencing the primary key of table product types, which we will create in a moment. Instead of storing all type data in table products, we're going to create a new table, call it product types, and store all available types in there. Then we will link that new table to table products using the primary key of product types. Let me show you why using another example. Take a look at column city in the sample database here. You'll notice that there is only a set number of cities available, which causes for a lot of data duplication, which is frankly a poor practice, as it wastes valuable server disk space. Also, take a closer look at employee 6 over here. Notice how London is written down incorrect when compared to the other employees. So if I were to run this query over here, employee 6 would not show up in the results, even though he is living in London, but is not showing up because of a human error. This problem could have easily been avoided by storing all cities in a separate table and linking them to table employees by using foreign keys. Let me show you. So what I did was, I created a new table and I stored all available cities in it. And then I replaced the city values by the primary key of table city. I can easily get the complete city information by running this query. So I'm joining both tables together using the foreign key of table employees and the primary key of table city. So when I run that, you can easily see that the information has been joined. Also, if I were to update table city, if I were, for example, replace Kirkland by Boston, all Kirkland cities will be replaced by Boston. Needless to say, there are several advantages to using foreign keys. One being that there is far less data duplication. A simple integer takes up a lot less space than a whole string. It's easier to keep errors out, since we can no longer misspell strings. And it's easier to maintain data. When we need to update a row, we simply need to edit a single row, and all linked records will display the correct updated data. So once again, I hope I got my point through. Now let's create a linked table. So go back to your GarageDB and create a new table. This one is going to need only two columns. The first one being the ID, primary column. So call it ID, data type int, set as primary key, and make sure that identity specification is set to yes. In column 2, it's going to be called name and give it a data type of varchar 50. No nulls. Save it and call it product types. Now let's link these two tables together with a foreign key or relationship. I find that the easiest way of adding relationships between tables is by using database diagrams. Look for the database diagrams folder in your database, right click it and select new database diagram. If you get a prompt asking you to install support objects, simply click yes. Next you'll get an overview of all the tables in your database. Add them both, so that we can drag relationships between them. First, a quick word about relationships. Relationships are basically a way to enforce data integrity between linked tables. So what do they do? Well, for example, they make sure that you cannot insert a row that has no corresponding data in one of its linked tables. For example, suppose that there are three rows in table product types, numbered 1, 2, and 3, and product types is linked to type ID in table product. We can only insert a new row in table product that has a type ID value of either 1, 2, or 3. Any other value will not be accepted. The same is true for deleting data. For example, suppose that we have several rows in table product with a type ID value of the number 2. As long as we have rows in table product with this type ID, we will not be able to delete row 2 from table product types, as it would cause the type ID value in table product to no longer correspond to the correct value in table product types. I hope that made sense. Now let me show you how you can easily create a relationship. To create a relationship, simply click on the primary key value in table product types and drag it over to column type ID. This will automatically create a relationship between those two columns. And hit the OK button. We can also put some constraints on our relationships, of which two are of particular interest. Look for the insert and update specification and expand the tab. There is a delete rule and an update rule with four actions each. No action, cascade, set null, or set default. The no action method, as its name suggests, does absolutely nothing when a row gets either updated or deleted. The other three actions do something, corresponding to their name, either updating or deleting linked data. Let me explain with a simple example. Head back over to your database diagram and hit the save button. You'll get a save prompt notifying you about the tables that will be affected. And just select yes and your foreign key relationship will automatically be enforced. Alright, example time. So I added a bit of sample data to our tables. I added three types to table product types, and I added 10 products two table products, each with their own type ID. First of all, notice how I cannot insert a product that has a type ID that is not in table product types. So if I try to run this query, then it simply will not work. If I were to add a type for two product types, then this query will work. So that's what data enforcing is all about. Now let's look at what happens when I set a cascading relationship. You can check the relations between tables at any time by entering a table in design mode, right-clicking it, and selecting relationships. So I set the delete rule to cascade, and as mentioned before, if I delete a row in a linked table, all linked rows should be deleted as well. So let's try that out. So we have three rows that have type ID 2. Let's see what happens if I remove type 2 from product types. So the row has been deleted. Now let's open up table product again. And as you can see, all rows with type ID 2 have been deleted. This is a great way to keep your data organized. As mentioned before, the method setNull or setDefault do not delete the rows, but actually set the linked column value, which is type ID in this case, to either null or a default value. Feel free to try that out in your own time. The last thing which we need to do is create a table for the products that are in a user's shopping cart. I promised that I would also show you how to create a table by writing down SQL manually. So let's create the last table with SQL code instead of using the designer. Click the New Query button in the top left corner of Management Studio and start writing down some code for a new table. As mentioned before, the table for the shopping cart is going to need the following columns: a column for the primary key, another linked column, which will link us to the ID of the users table, which we'll learn in a later lesson when I show you about logging in and registration, a linked column that links to the product table to determine which product is being purchased, a column containing an integer detailing how many of a specific products are being purchased, a date column for the date of when the product has been added to the cart, and a boolean value to determine whether a product is in a shopping cart or has already been purchased. So let's get this over with. Just write the code that I write. I'll explain the most important parts in a few seconds. There we go. That's all we need to do to create a SQL table by typing in code manually. So a quick explanation. We first invoke the createTable method and we give our table a name. Then we type in the name of a column, the data type of a column. We specify whether a column can or cannot be a null value. And we add some optional parameters. I added an identity parameter to column ID, 1-1. That means that the first row being created will be row 1, and the future rows will be incremented by 1 each. So that's one, row 1, row 2, row 3, If I were to replace this by 2, for example, then we would have row 1, row 3, row 5, and so on and so on. I also added a default constraint here, meaning that when we insert a row and we do not pass a value for column date purchased, that it will automatically trigger the getDate method, which returns the date when the query was executed. And last but not least, I added a primary key constraint on the ID column. Now let's link this column to table product as well. Go back to your database diagram, right-click the white area and select Add Table, and add your new cart table. Just the same as with product types, select your ID parameter, your product ID parameter, and drag and drop it to the ID parameter of product, and hit the OK button. We do not need to add any foreign key relationships here, so the default values will do. And don't forget to save your database diagram so that your database tables and relationships get rebuilt. These type of relations are also known as a one-to-many relation, meaning a product can only have one product type, but a product type can have many products. Likewise, a product can exist in many carts, but a product in a cart is still just that, a single product. One last thing which I would like to discuss today are indexes. An index is a constraint that you can put on a column that indexes or sorts a column so that queries fired against that column will be much easier and much faster to retrieve. Let me explain by using an example. Let's take another look at the employee table in the sample Northwind database. By default, a table is sorted by its primary key. As you can see, all employees are ordered by their number, which is also their primary key, without having to use an order by statement. Now suppose if I were to run a query that returns all employees whose first name starts with an M. Since the table is automatically ordered by its employee number, SQL Server needs to go through each and every row individually to see if there is an M over here. And see, there's an M over here, none over here. Oh, there's one over here. There might be some left. Nope, there are none. Here are all the results. If I had placed an index on the first name column, then the table would automatically be sorted by first name. And then SQL Server knows that it needs to start looking on row 6 and needs to look no further than row 7, since it knows that there can be no M after N. To create a new index on column client ID, simply type in the following SQL code. And hit execute. There we go. So I think that's everything for today. As always, thank you for watching. I hope you found this lesson useful. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask me them in the comment section below this video or on the forums. There is a link in the description below the video as well. So once again, thank you for watching and be sure to check in for our next lesson, in which you will learn how we can connect this database to our web application using the Entity Framework.